to welcome practitioner and my brother in truth, Mr. Vance Gardiner, to the podium to give us this morning's message. Vance.
Thank you, Sonia. It is my pleasure to speak to you this morning, and let me welcome you all again, and those who are listening or either seeing this on the World Wide Web. In Jamaica, fairly regularly, we greet each other by saying, Wagwan, what a gwan. Even recently, when President Obama visited, he greeted his audience by asking, what a gwan, Jamaica? My answer to this greeting is, God a gwan, and everything is airy. If you feel that way, you ought to repeat after me, God a gwan, and everything airy. I know some of you may prefer to say, God is working in my life and all is well. So if that makes you feel better, you can also say that. God is working in my life and all is well. God is always working in our lives, but we experience this to the extent that we allow it. I remember that I heard that on January 21st, 1985, some of the biggest recording stars in the music industry were gathered together for a recording session. Quincy Jones, one of the producers of this project, said he made only one request of those participating, and it was that they leave their egos at the door. The single, We Are the World, sold in excess of 20 million copies, and the organizers were able to donate US$63 million to charity. Great things can happen when we learn to control our egos. Or as Emerson put it, let us take our bloated nothingness out of the path of the divine circuits. Today, therefore, I'll speak on only one idea, and that it is best to allow life and live. Or as I would say when speaking to my close friends, allow life and live. Or, you know, God a gwan, and everything is airy. Emma Curtis Hopkins' 11th lesson in unveiling our hidden power, as its axiom, judgment is as great and competent as will and meekness can agree. I prefer, however, how the Sufi poet Rumi states this principle, as we heard this morning. Yesterday, I was clever and wanted to change the world. Today, I am wise and changing myself. From my experience and speaking to other people, I discern, to put it mildly, that many people like myself get frustrated when things don't go as we expected. The tendency is to say, if such and such would only change, or something works some other way, like, oh, I want things to work, then everything is great. But today, I am wiser, and I pray the serenity prayer. I'm learning to allow life. So what is life? In a famous hymn, we are told that in all life, God lives, the true life of all. And in our Declaration of Principle, it is stated that the life of all is God. God is the real life, or life in the absolute, that is love, peace, abundance, joy, health, light, and right action. The life in the heaven of our consciousness, but we experience this life in the earth of our everyday living to the extent that we allow it. Emma Curtis Hopkins suggests it is good to follow our will, as long as we are willing to yield our point the instant we recognize that our way isn't working. She goes on to say that when we come to a point where we don't quickly know what to do, we are in an unbalanced state of mind called ignorance or foolishness. This comes about when we follow our egos or our own will, regardless of everything and ignore our higher judgment rather than meekly accepting it. She then tells us the key to allowing, that is compelling our meekness to combine with our will. Meekness means yielding only to spiritual principle, even when appearances seem to argue louder than the reality. We can still say, God are gone and everything airy. I remember an incident in Dr. King's life when he was confronted by an angry detractor during one of his rallies. The man walked up to Dr. King and spat in his face. The Reverend sighed and hesitated only for a moment before he took out his handkerchief and wiped the spittle off his face. Then in a voice filled with compassion, he angled the handkerchief back to the man and said, I believe this belongs to you. He only yielded to the spiritual principle that the life of all is God and saw Christ in this person. There are moments when the illusory power of outward appearance seems to spit into our faces and say, take that, you are not good enough. You are not smart enough. You are not good looking enough to deserve that. You don't have the money to do that or the education to do that. There are people doing that already. You can't compete. You are never going to amount to much. You must have done something to deserve that, or even worse, God is punishing you. We must not yield to these false suggestions and impressions of conditions, but yield only to the spiritual principle and allow life to express through us as light, abundance, success, and compassion, and all the good that God, our true life, is. We stand on the principle that there is a power for good and that we can use it, knowing that it is our all-sufficiency and the only true power. Allowing life is not accepting conditions and the illusory false evidence appearing to be real. There's only one power, and it's the power for good. And we can use it by being an open channel for its expression in and as our life. We don't resist conditions and situations. We stand in our power and know, as it is said so many times in the Bible, as to that this is the phrase that occurred the most in the Bible, it came to pass. And I was watching television this week when I heard a commentator said that he found it amazing and remarkable that the relatives and loved ones of the people killed in the church in Charleston were able to forgive the killer. Remarkable that the killer, trying to start a race war, instead got a response from people yielding to principle that is now healing America. And I wonder what would have happened if after the events of September 11, 2001, there was a similar response by the government of the United States. I'm just wondering. This teaching, the science of mind, is a practical form of spirituality. I'm not suggesting that we ignore facts and conditions, but facts and conditions are changeable because they are a reflection of our beliefs and states of consciousness. The painful conditions in our life reveal to us the beliefs and states of consciousness that we need to heal. Pain is a part of life on this journey of unfoldment, but suffering is optional, because when we change the way we look at things, the things we look at change, as Wayne Dyer says. Nelson Mandela tells a story in A Long Walk to Freedom that he was placed in solitary confinement by the apartheid government to try to break him. But he recognized that this presented an opportunity for him to negotiate. Now, both sides in that conflict had vowed never to negotiate until the other side denounced their former positions. By placing Mandela in solitary confinement, it meant that he had to take decisions on his own. The government had tried to get him to buy his own freedom by accepting the status quo, but he refused. This was at first what they wanted to talk to him about, but he continued to refuse and insisted that what he wanted to talk about was the ending of apartheid. Now, President de Klerk, the last president of the apartheid era, made this observation in his memoirs, that Mandela was a skillful negotiator, that he always got what he wanted, but he always allowed his opponent to save face. Yeah. So that he only yielded to the principle of being a channel for peace and freedom by going out on his own and starting the negotiations that would change his country and the world for better. We don't allow life by resisting conditions, but by accepting higher principles as our state of being. Gandhi said, "We must be the change we want to see so that the good we desire can manifest through us, because one in alignment with the infinite is a majority." So how do we allow life and live? How do we know without a doubt that God is working our lives and all is well? Ernest Holmes, in the sermon by the sea, says, "Find me one person who is for something and against nothing, who is redeemed enough not to condemn others out of the burden of his soul, and I will find another Savior, another Jesus, an exalted human being. Find me one person who no longer has any fear of the universe, or of God, or of man, or of anything else, and you'd have brought to me someone in whose presence we may sit, and fear shall vanish as clouds before the sunlight." Our true life is often asleep, so to speak. And some of us has passed a death sentence on it by believing we are too old, too weak. Sorry. Some of us are even so asleep as to be experiencing what is like a nightmare, the mistaken idea that our skin color, our ethnicity, our nationality, our sexual orientation, or our physical body means that it is not realistic to live our true lives. Sorry, excuse me. When the Master Jesus was teaching near the River Jordan, it is said that news came to him from his close friends, Mary and Martha, that his good friend, their brother Lazarus, is ill, and that Jesus needed to hurry to Bethany to help, or Lazarus will die. Sorry. The Master, while acknowledging this message, didn't yield to the false suggestion that he needed to hurry back to Bethany. Instead, he continued his ministry, and when he was ready, he said to his disciples, "Our friend Lazarus is falling asleep, but I will go and wake him out of sleep." His disciples reminded him that it was not safe to go back to Bethany because the priests were plotting against him. He didn't yield to their fear because he trusted the Father within. Jesus said he was going to do this so that his Father would be glorified. Sorry. Thank you. A Lazarus represents our sleeping life, awaiting our acceptance of our divinity and oneness with God. Bringing this sleeping life into our consciousness is no easy task. The Gospel of John tells us that when Jesus arrived, he was told that Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. The people knew that to raise Lazarus would be Jesus' greatest demonstration of his relationship with the Father and the power available if we too enter into this relationship with the Father within. Mary and Martha told Jesus to come and see where Lazarus lay. And the Bible told us that Jesus wept. I believe there are two reasons for this. The first is to remind us that Jesus was also human. And the second, that despite being so close to him, they had not grasped the lesson of the divinity within man. He was also humbling himself to allow the Father within to do the work. Jesus then said, "Take away the stone." Now, the metaphysical meaning of this, as stated by Truth Unity, is that the stone holds our sleeping life in the tomb of matter in subconsciousness. It is the belief in the permanency of present material laws. This stone must be rolled away through faith. The man who wants the inner life to spring forth must believe in the reality of spiritual powers and must exercise this faith by invoking in prayer the presence of the invisible but omnipresent God. When this stone of yielding to conditions is removed and we yield only to spiritual principle, that is the knowledge of our oneness of God, our oneness with God, we move that knowledge from our awareness into our consciousness, and God will be glorified through our lives, and we will demonstrate a power greater than we have ever imagined. God is our true life. Through affirmative prayer and diligent spiritual practices, we grow into this realization. Our best and highest life can only come into full manifestation when we release all false beliefs and see and yield only to the good and the highest at all times. We are spiritual beings having a human experience, and this teaching, the Science of Mind, is to help us to remember that spirit is our true life, immortal, eternal, limitless goodness. This infinite life expresses itself in countless ways as the life of all our lives. We have to discover this truth for ourselves by going within and listening to that inner voice calling unto us. This guidance may also come from friends, people who know us, even strangers, or visions of masters like Jesus and Buddha, or visions of our departed loved ones, or as said in a song, Mother Mary. Within is also without. So spirit reveals itself to us in ways that we can grasp, but we are always reminded at all times of our true life. So let us remove the stone of the belief in appearances and conditions and yield only to truth. It is the way and the life calling Lazarus to come forth. Many of us think the abundant life, healthy, energized, fulfilling life is dead to us. It is only asleep, waiting for you to say yes to the call. This is the moment. Now is the time, and the life you save may be your own. Namaste.